And then we can get started. So thank you so much for joining the March 2022 club meeting. And we have an awesome guest and club member, Peter Fold, that's going to go over a presentation about home malting and even maybe touch on his automated machine that he's got a prototype of. That sounds really cool. And so he'll be going through that after we go through some of the, you know, club notes, updates, events, things like that. And then if you guys have anything that you want to bring up, go for it. So there's a couple items that I have on my list. One that I'll go through, and then since Stu was so kind to join this time, maybe he can touch on. I did summarize some of the things in regards to a party. That Stu is like I'm gonna call him the party planner because he's got a lot of great ideas. But before we do that, one really cool thing that I wanted you all to know about is that the National Homebrew Competition registration is open, and it's open between the 22nd and the 29th. That means there's 3 more days to register for that. And once it's full, it's full. You can't register. The shipping window for that is May 24th to June 3rd. So if you're looking to brew beers for that competition, then you need to think about those dates, obviously, to ship. I think it's HomebrewCon is where that judging is being done. That's in Pittsburgh this year. So plan on shipping your beers, I believe, to Pittsburgh. Not sure about that. New in 2022, I don't know if you guys saw this. This is pretty cool. There is a dedicated gluten-free category. It's category 35A, according to what I just submitted this morning. Now, you guys, we've kind of debated this on the Facebook page for many, many times, and for over the last couple of years. Some people say don't even go into the previous category, which is alternative grains. So this competition is a little bit special, I think, because they've created a dedicated gluten-free category, which is not a BJPC type thing. It's like they just went off on their own and did that. So that's really cool for our club. I know some people will just say, hey, just submit your beers into the native category. Go ahead and do that if you want. We're not, you know, it doesn't bother me. I would personally say, and Stuart and I had kind of, I am back and forth about this. I mean, it'd be pretty cool to have a bunch of beers submitted into that new category, even though it's, you know, it's not a native category style, just because it's something special they created, right? So that category has, I'll just read you kind of the brief description of that. It says, seeing a rise in interest in gluten-free beers, the competition is introducing a GF category this year. They go on to specify things pretty specifically, you know, here. So all ingredients must be free of gluten within the framework of these guidelines. Beers brewed with barley, wheat, spelt rye, and other gluten-containing ingredients may not be categorized as gluten-free. Gluten-free beers that may contain malted grains that are gluten-free, gluten-reduced should not be entered into this style. So I think from historical perspectives that some people got a little hot under the collar for some of the winners of the alternative grains categories, you know, just like throwing rye into their IPA and calling it, you know, alternative, right? So this category is something that's available for us to brew and submit to. So if you want to do that, you have to be an AHA member. It's $29 to enter. One of the big things I found last year that was difficult is it takes a bunch of beers. You have to send a bunch of beers, right? So you have to send, because they started doing it differently because of COVID, I think. So it's 6 12-ounce bottles or 4 20-ounce bottles is what you have to send. And you send them all at once. So they don't have these regional places where they're judging and then a final. They just do it all at once. So I thought I would mention that as something that's kind of cool. I had emailed the guy that runs at John Moorhead a while back, and Dave, what's his name? Carpenter, maybe. And they were pretty receptive to, they said, oh, take it up with BJCP. And of course that went to a whole pile of nothing, right? So I think that, you know, they've definitely gotten input from people in this club about, you know, how that would be pretty cool to have. So I'm going to submit a beer in that category, and I hope other people do as well. So if you are going to do that, you have 3 days to sign up. Awesome. So the next item is this idea of having a club 2022 party in the summer. And I put a poll up on the Facebook page maybe a week ago or something like that to see, selfishly, to see if people want to have it in Seattle, right? But of course, the consensus was, nah, we don't want to do that. That sucks. Seattle sucks. So we want to do it down in Portland. I think there's a large group of membership that are in Portland, and I have no problem doing it in Portland. I think that's awesome. And I think it's cool maybe over time to have it at different places, you know, and experience those, you know, maybe other commercial locations. So I think at this point, we are probably going to look to do it in Portland. And late summer was what Stuart and I were throwing around, but we're open for anyone's, you know, comments or what they think would be your best. But the date we were actually looking at, Stuart and I were looking at, was August 27th. And in addition to that, since neither Stuart and I are in Portland area, it would be great if we got a club member or two that's down in that area that could help with coordinating, planning, yada, 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 stuff like that. So other than that, so Stuart, you had sent me like a laundry list of brainstorming ideas that I have written down here, but I would be happy to toss it to you to kind of like, just, so we were tossing around ideas of things that would be cool. And not necessarily having to do all those, but just kind of maybe, do you want to just kind of brush on a couple of those?
Yeah, sure. Yeah. So, so just in terms of location and stuff, I think the question marks are, you know, timing, location, and then how many people would we be hosting, and do we, you know, where would we host it? You know, I think the first and last party was a Groundbreaker, and I wasn't there, unfortunately, for that, but that sounded like a good time. I don't know if we can assume that that's an option or not. Probably, obviously, we need to talk to different people. But, and Kim, you've got a thought on that? Are you willing to host?
I noticed that Jason Yerger offered Mutantis.
Oh, did he? Okay. I was wondering
about that. And there's actually a restaurant that's entirely gluten-free next door, too. So that might actually be a pretty cool place to do it.
Yeah.
Kim, a question on that. Have you been inside the Mutantis before? Is it what? And from a size perspective, I know that Groundbreaker, the back room where we had it before, was pretty small. But how, from
it's
the
more,
size,
it's even more cramped now because they got more equipment.
So is Jason's place bigger than that?
I would say the back part, I would say, Kim, is bigger than Groundbreaker.
I haven't seen that, but the front is small, but in the summer he has an area outside and they share between Tamale Boy. It should be plenty big enough, I would think, outside especially.
Yeah, that's cool.
Okay.
So that's the kind of stuff I guess we need to firm up if this is actually going to happen. And so just some of the ideas that we were kicking around were obviously I get together, see if we can get a bunch of different beers from different commercial breweries. That would be awesome. If we could share some home brews as well, I think that would be great. When one mashup of that idea was to do a kind of a March Madness ladder idea, sort of a People's Choice Award, where we'd have brackets of home brews and commercial beers, blind tasting, and coming up with semi-finalists and finalists in a not too serious competition, but just sort of a whatever, end of the day, Saturday revealing of a crowd favorite. So that was one of the ideas. And then kind of on the more nerdy side, or just, you know, sort of a club perspective, if there are opportunities, if we really had the full day, say people assembled on, you know, we're in Portland by Friday night and we had all day Saturday, you know, there is maybe some opportunities to do some stuff that we talk about, and you know, where all the sensory stuff is up to you in your house and whatever, with in your backyard, where we could be doing some stuff together that could be interesting. So, you know, whether that's hop samples or triangle tests for different kind of malt combinations and beers, and you know, actually do some you know, sort of brewing experiments, that could be one idea. An equipment yard sale, I guess, is another thing that came up. If people have got equipment that they have to move on, or they're looking for stuff, that might be another opportunity to bring people together. And of course, I'm, you know, and hope, as a guy who has to go across the border to get my grain, be good to maybe do a grain kind of purchase and you know, have the different retailers there to provide the stuff that we've ordered and have a pickup. So that was maybe two or three of the ideas we were kicking around, but I'm sure there are other fine ideas out there.
I think that the other couple ones that I wrote down was t-shirts and stickers, you know, maybe doing another t-shirts and have them pick bottle up openers. There. What was that?
Bottle openers.
Yeah, exactly. So there's definitely a lot of ideas, and I think that the goal was just to get people together, right? And to have a good time. That's as simple as it is, right? And for me, like, all that other stuff could be tossed aside, and I just want to drink beer with some people that are like-minded people, right? The other stuff is just kind of icing on the cake, right? So
we could do a tour of all of the breweries in the Portland area. Yeah, do a gluten-free pub crawl.
Yeah, I mean, we could do a day before to anybody who wants to come down on a Friday or something like that, or, you know, donuts on Sunday or something like that. The other idea, I don't know, did anybody mention like brewing together sort of thing?
Oh yeah,
because
yeah.
that's always kind of
yeah,
a thing. So yeah. I know that I'm Team Brewzilla when it comes to my pilot system. Brian knows this. Yeah, right. Kim's got a Brewzilla, and Kim's in Portland. Jason's got a 35 liter Brewzilla that he's using now as a pilot system up at Mutantis. I've got a 5 gallon mash and boil that I could lend to, that's already converted for gluten-free. All of these are already converted for gluten-free. And then I also have a 65 liter heavily modified Brewzilla that's also great for gluten-free. That takes 220 power, which I don't think Jason has, but all those other ones are all 110. So we could potentially brew multiple styles and go through some stuff, you know, with skills and different things like that, because there's definitely, you know, for some of us, each one could be like a different kind of extended skill that we're just like showing people, like, hey, you know, here's one way to brew with 50% buckwheat and not hate your life for the day.
Yeah, no, that's a great idea. And even milling and seeing what a crush looks like for, you know, people who are new to that. Yeah, I think that's a fantastic idea. Yeah, we kicked that one around, but I think that just extends that idea even more, just having it as a bit of a learning opportunity too, depending on where you're at.
Yeah, and we know that those three systems that are all 5 gallon systems, those are already within, you know, 40 miles of Jason's place. So
yeah.
Okay. And I could bring my oh, what's that new mill I bought?
Oh yeah, your Maltzilla or something like that.
Yeah, Maltzilla. I was trying to remember the name, but it'd be fun to run, like, compare that side by side with JP's mill.
Yeah, I've got the
gluten-free homebrew mill.
I've got the prototype Monster Brewing Hardware. I was the one that prototyped that and then handed the specs over to Brian Kolasinski for the gluten-free edition for that. Yeah. So
okay,
mine, I think the only difference with mine is I believe I know I have heat treated rollers. I don't think the gluten-free edition has the heat treated rollers, but
I have that one.
The heat treated rollers. Yeah.
No, they don't have heat treated rollers. I have the one that Brian sells.
So that's the only difference. Other than that, I've got the extension on mine too, but they're exactly the same.
Yeah, that's a great idea.
Yeah, those are all great ideas. So I think that what we want to do is just lock in a date and a place as soon as possible, and the other stuff can kind of just come go around that.
If you guys need some help since I'm down here, just message me and I'll do what I can.
Oh, perfect. Thanks, Kim. Awesome. Yep. That's great. And we hope that everyone can. I know, Peter, you're like kind of far away, but
what?
Everyone is welcome, right? Everyone is welcome.
You can do it.
Yeah, I might just win the lottery until then.
Yeah. So, okay, cool. We want to get some time for Peter to do his present. So before we do, anyone else have anything that they want to mention? Brian, I think you had mentioned something about your store, how you had different malts in stock. You want to mention anything about that?
I've got... I'm restocked on the pale oats. See, I've got all the three oat malts in. I've got pale millet and I've got sorghum malt back in. So sometimes it's a little bit of a challenge getting the supplies in. So I've got them stocked up now, though.
Are they like stuck on a boat in like the Suez Canal or something? Or
No, it's more of building up enough money to make a sizable order so that the shipping makes sense,
right?
Because shipping from across the country can get, like, I think the pallet or the half pallet was still $200, so I really have to buy half a pallet to have it make sense. And the oats I get out of Ohio, but I just saved that for when I was I went to Cleveland.
Okay.
Shipping is no joke right now. In the chat, in the chat window, I threw that a 5-gallon size batch of the Native Land IPA on the chat window in Zoom.
Put that up on our
that's fine. Yeah. And that's Beersmith. You know what? Let me make sure that my brewer's name is on that too before you throw that up. Okay. I might throw another version on that.
Okay. Yeah, sounds good.
All right, excellent. Anyone else with any hot topics before we get into the meat of the...
I had fun at She Brew. I got to do a collab brew with Groundbreaker.
Yeah.
Oh, great. What did you brew?
S'more stout.
Nice.
It's pretty good.
was it just put on kegs or
that's what you got in your hand, right?
Oh, cool. Look at that.
Limited edition.
Yep.
Oh, nice. Awesome. And you have they only have that in the cans in the tap room. They're not distributing those or
they're selling it at Mutantis, so maybe. Okay. You have to ask Jesse about that.
Okay. Cool. Awesome.
But it's on tap at the tap room and they're selling cans of it.
Nice. Yeah.
50 pounds of campfire marshmallows were roasted to go into the beer.
That's nuts.
Holy mackerel.
Like one at a time?
No, they had them like laid out. It's crazy.
So 100 pounds of campfire marshmallows were devoted to this project because the brewers ate half of them. No. But everybody had to eat half of them, you know.
Oh, well, that might happen too. I don't know.
You got to take a bite out of each one so you get the amylase enzymes.
Nope, not good. Destroy it.
Yummy.
Quality control.
Okay, so let's give Peter some time for his presentation. So without further ado, Peter has a lot of experience in the home malting front, I think out of necessity than out of in a lot of respects, and I'm sure he'll go through that. So Peter, I'm going to give the floor to you, and I think I might need to allow you to share your screen. So let me turn that on and go ahead. And if you want to try sharing your screen now.
Oh yeah. Thanks. Ah, okay, nice. So yeah, thanks everyone for joining. I have to say up front, I don't know how to malt marshmallows. I'm logged in here with two accounts actually. One is a backup, so let me just make a quick change, and I'm gonna stop the video because I will be I'm sharing the screen anyway. And that's where that's where our focus should be. Okay. Can you guys hear me well?
Yes, sir.
Yes, okay, thanks, great. So I'm gonna start the presentation here. Can you also see my screen?
Yes, sir.
Nice, thank you. Okay, so yeah, welcome. I'm honored by the presence of each and every one of you. So a quick introduction. As Kjell said, I'm a home master by necessity. You can see on this map, I'm located quite far from, I think, all of you, western part of Hungary. And, you know, the landscape here is very different. Gluten-reduced beers are marketed as gluten-free still, and those cover the market. So there is very little happening on the genuine gluten-free scene. Unfortunately, in all of Europe, so it's not a surprise, I guess, that genuinely gluten-free malts and homebrew kits and whatnot, they are not available. So about 6 years ago, when I first found out about genuine gluten-free beers, and I started thinking about trying to make some, I actually came across this legendary Andrew Lowery, sorry if I'm not pronouncing correctly, tutorial, and I totally recommend that to anyone. It is still one of the best resources up there on the internet. And by the way, this presentation we will of course put online, and you will be able to read through this material if you find it, if you find any information interesting. So yeah, I would like to ask you if any of you have tried malting yourselves already, or if you are thinking about doing it. What are your thoughts on that?
I tried, I've never tried malting, but I did do like the Ed Golden, like soak the pale millet in Termamil, and then roast it to get like your own kind of caramel millets. But I'm personally not thought about malting grains because I just buy them, right? And they get shipped to the house, right?
Yeah. Yeah. And how did that turn out?
It turned out pretty good. I think that it took way longer. I think I had too much water in there, so it took way longer. Mm-hmm. It became like an all day kind of experience because I had too much water in there. So I think that definitely it would require some experimentation. And I think if you're trying to get darker roasts, you have to be pretty careful about burning things because it happens pretty quick.
Okay. So what you did there is actually, if I understood that correctly, is basically the equivalent of creating a crystal mold. So it's like also basically mashing the grains in the oven, right? And that actually crystal malt would have similar properties to it. Okay, well, part of my goal here is to demystify malting a little bit, so it's not it's not super crazy complicated. It's actually pretty simple. But what I think is complicated about it is definitely getting really good quality at the end. Mm-hmm. Is that, I guess, could be complicated. But if somebody wants to try it, I mean, the worst thing that can happen is that you have to clean your kitchen and throw some grains out to the garbage or the chickens. Okay, so.
Oh, it looks like Brian's got his hand up. Do you have a question, Brian?
Well, I was raising my hand because that last slide said raise your hand if you.
Oh, yeah.
I've got a, there's a little secret sort of, what do you call it? Advanced peak. I might be working with a local meadery on some gluten-free beer, and they exclusively and only use products made and grown in Michigan. So we're looking into some options, and malting on our own might end up being one of them.
Okay. Sounds cool. Sounds good. Cool. Yeah. Sounds exciting. Yeah. Maybe you could tell us about that later.
Or you can use some of this presentation to figure out how to do it.
I think I have to do that part first.
Okay. Yeah, by the way, I want to, there will be some practice and some theory I will talk about here. I would like to get through it relatively quickly, and then we can have a discussion and Q&A. So I guess it... it's worth sticking till the end. So just a quick 101, like how you can do very basic gluten-free malting process at home. These are some cheap pictures that I took in the beginnings. So I will start with lentils or buckwheat, and I will talk about this more later, but there is a difference between gluten-free grains, how difficult they are to germinate and malt, and I would say lentils and buckwheat are the easiest, so that's the most likely you will have some great results. Steep the amount you want in a bucket of cold water, ideally in a mesh bag, a brew in a bag will work completely fine for 12 to 24 hours. Strain them, so the mesh bag comes useful when straining them. Spread them out on a tray and put them in a place where the room where the temperature is a little cooler than room temperature, so somewhere between 10 and 20 degrees Celsius. And if there's no sign of life for a couple of days, then you will need to repeat the steeping and the straining and banging them out tray process. And after that, you should see them growing. If really they are not growing, then you will have to go for a different source of grains. So basically, then it's quite sure that your grains are not viable with lentils or buckwheat, at least. But I will talk about this more later. And then when the egg respire is two times as long as the grain, that's just a rough rule of thumb, then you can put the trays in tray in an oven and dry them and even roast them, if you will. So what is the purpose of malting? Why are we doing this at all? Starches start to break down, enzymes are produced. It helps with the so-called gelatinization. We hear this a lot in gluten-free brewing. Flavor compounds are created mostly in the kilning or toasting part. Also, coloring compounds are created, and the moisture is removed, so they store for a long time, long shelf life. Now, this question has come up already in the Facebook discussions. If you can make beer with only unmalted grains using exogenous enzymes, because we use them anyway, mostly in gluten-free brewing. And the answer is yes, but because of these reasons that I selected here in red, the beer will lack flavor and color. Might also lack a little bit of yield, so you might, but for sure, you know, if you use just raw grains and they are not toasted, they're not not kilned, and also they're not toasted or kilned in the way that they have previously went through the malting, the germination process, in which they produce sugars. So sugars then could be caramelized with the famous Maillard reaction. Then this will all be lacking from the beer. So it's well, it's just better to make beer with malt, right? So how do you prepare for malting? You have to make sure that you have a good quality of source, and the grains need to be able to germinate, but also good for human consumption, of course. There's this interesting term called quiescent seed. It's just a fun fact, basically, that seeds after harvest, the grains, they need to rest. And that's just basically due to the rhythm of nature, as far as I understand. You want to do some tests if your grains are viable, and if it might be the case that they have some mold on them, you know, and you just it's just very little, but when you test then it really test their germination, then it really becomes in a wet condition, it really becomes apparent that there is a mold problem. You have to remove contaminants. I mean, of course, the best is if you can just source grains without any contamination. I mean, this could be anything, you know, not just obviously you want to source gluten-free, so make sure there's no gluten contamination, but sometimes there could be other inorganic materials, so you have to make sure. You can also remove the non-viable grains, so they would float on the surface of the steeping water. And also an interesting and quite useful fun fact is that these grains are alive. So they actually, even when they are in dormancy, they actually do breathe. They do produce a little bit of heat, and you have to store them accordingly. So where this becomes important is if you have a larger bag of grains and you don't want to put them in an environment like a plastic bag, or where they are sealed completely, because you might have some condensation, and then that might lead to mold, and you might also choke the grains. So best is to put them in a place where they can breathe.
Peter, can I interrupt you and ask a question?
Yes, of course.
Where do you source your seeds? How have you figured out where to go to get viable malting
okay.
product?
Yeah, it's a good question, and it's also kind of tough question. So for like rice, I have a very good source, but then for millet, I'm still looking for different sources. Some have worked out better in the past, some haven't. With rice, it's very easy for me to make sure that it's completely gluten-free. It's less with others, And also buckwheat is an interesting one because just geographically they don't grow buckwheat here where I live. They do grow it in neighboring countries and quite close, but I'm still so buckwheat I bought so far was imported from Poland, and so those I got in just a general gluten-free store for food products, but for rice I managed to contact basically a rice producing company, like a large farming company, and they were happy to help. So you know, it's I guess this is the toughest part of homeworking really, is where to get the grains from. Yeah. I also grew some. I used to experiment with growing sorghum and millet, also buckwheat, but it's fun, but it's you know, it's a lot of work, and it's also a different trade. So
right.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, we I continue, and maybe we can talk about this later more. Okay, so the first step in malting is germination. The others would be steeping comes. Sorry, so steeping comes first, but that's a part of the germination process, and then drying the grains, kilning them or toasting, in other words, and decalming, which is the removal of the acrous spires or shoots. In germination, we are simulating the circumstances in the environment. So basically, the seeds and grains are programmed in a way that when they get wet enough and the temperature rises high enough, they just start growing. And that's what we go for here. At the same time, we are creating circumstances in which life life is promoted, but this is also promoting to pathogens and mold. So that's something we have to be mindful of. For this reason, germination needs to be quicker in malting than in nature. You know, in the nature, sometimes it rains and then it doesn't rain for a long time. So germination can be a lengthy process. And also the rise of the temperature is not so even. So the key promoting factor is actually the grain viability. And this really matters. Sometimes you might get grains from a source which just will not germinate at all. Sometimes you get some that germinate very easily. I really recommend to do tests, and if you have problems with the grain that comes from one particular source, then just ditch that and try and get some from a better source. And then, as I mentioned earlier, the other promoting factors are the water absorption and the temperature. And mold can be made more difficult to grow by lowering temperatures, adequate ventilation, and of course making the process quick as possible. And exogenous substances can be used. Gibberellic acid is basically an enzyme that promotes the initial growth phase of the grains, and other agents to help prevent mold can be used. Slake lime has been used for a very long time traditionally in malting. I do not recommend using that at home because it also needs to be removed afterwards, but it it works on the principle that it makes the pH higher, and actually baking soda also does that to some degree. So it's a bit anecdotal that baking soda helps prevent the growth of mold, but actually it does alter the pH, and in my experience it also helped preventing mold. So gluten-free grains, I made two large groups here. One would be buckwheat, lentils, and sorghum. The first group, buckwheat, lentils, and sorghum, as I said earlier, if you want to try malting at home, this is where you should start it, because these grains, not only they germinate at room temperature or even colder temperatures, so you don't need to really alter the temperatures. You can just put them in the pantry, or even outside on the terrace if it's not that cold anymore, and they will probably start germinating, and they also tend to germinate without the husk. So for example, for me in the beginning, sourcing buckwheats was only possible without the husk. That was buckwheat meant for as a food product, as a side dish, and but it germinated beautifully and it worked very well. Now with millet, corn, and rice, they tend not to germinate with the husk, so you have to source them, making sure that they are whole grain with the husk on, and also they germinate at higher temperatures. So millet, both for millet and rice, it would be like between 27 and 30 degrees Celsius. Sorry, I don't know how to translate that to Fahrenheit. Yeah, if anyone knows, then similarly for corn, it needs like 26 around 26 degrees Celsius, so it's not much, but a little higher than room temperature. So you need you need to use something to warm them, and that can become a problem, because if you let's say you put them on a heat radiator, then it's very easy to just go way above the correct temperature, and then mold will start to develop, and you will start having all sorts of problems. So I'm not saying it can't be done, but it's tricky.
On sorghum,
yes.
Do you actually malt the sorghum? I mean, I noticed the note says produces some cyanide, or do you just boil it before?
Oh, yes, thanks for pointing that out. Yeah. I have malted some sorghum, but I was very cautious there, so I didn't use much in my beer. Mm-hmm. But I, as far as I know, this cyanide is kind of volatile and it can be boiled off, but I do recommend caution there. And so, for example, I would not malt sorghum at home and then make a beer with, not even with 40 or 50% of the grain bill because of that.
27°C to 30°C is about 80 to 86 degrees Fahrenheit.
Okay. Yeah. Thanks, JP. Thanks for doing my homework for me.
Hey, Peter, I had a quick question on, I know Grant, who's down in Australia, had mentioned that when he has tried to procure millet for some home malting, some projects that he has his own kind of operation down there in Australia, he was saying that, I think he was saying that a lot of the grain that comes into Australia is irradiated. Do you know anything about
irradiation? I do know about some about irradiation, but so where I live, it's only used on spices. It's only allowed to be used on spices. Yeah. I won't get into the details why, but we don't use that on grains here. It probably there's a big difference there on geographically, but if they are irradiated, then there's a it's very likely that they won't be viable.
Right.
So, okay. And also it's also important to mention here that now that I'm talking about viable or non-viable grains, if you buy grains that are meant for agricultural purposes, like you know, actually sowing them in the fields, then those are usually treated with chemicals and they are absolutely not meant for human consumptions, unless they are organic, of course. So if that's also something you have to make sure of, that they are not not meant for that purpose and not treated with any chemicals.
Hey guys, can I just butt in quickly?
Yes, of course.
Yeah, so I'm Grant, the gluten-free brewer. So hello to everyone.
Hi.
So I just wanted to just answer a couple of questions there that you brought up. So with rice, and I don't know how you go over where you are, but here in Australia, we can malt rice that has been hulled, but it's the brown rice. So white rice is too far processed and the endosperm is dead. But we quite often, well, I have as well, and I know Andrew Lavery's just done a fair bit of it, the brown rice. So if you can find the brown rice without the hull on it, it should be okay to malt. So hope that helps.
Okay, thanks.
Well, I think we need to stop here and have this as a momentous occasion, as the first time an Australian has actually joined our club meeting. So thank you so much for doing that.
No worries. I just saw that you're I saw the Facebook post when I woke up, and I thought, oh, you made the effort. I've got to make the effort as well. So
thank you so much for joining.
That's good to have you on.
Yeah.
No worries. Continue on, Peter.
Thanks. But sorry for the remark. Did I understand correctly? You introduce yourself. Are you the gluten-free brewer who is?
Yes, correct. Yep.
Oh, okay. Well, nice to meet you then.
Same here, Peter. See you.
Yeah, okay. Well, with brown rice, I have actually also experimented with that. And my, unfortunately, that didn't work for me. So, and I also talked to the farmers about that, and that they told me that it might work and it might just not, and it didn't for me. So I just went for the, it's definitely much easier in my experience with the unhulled, so rice with husk. But I mean, this is totally in line with the my message here is that the varieties matter a lot. You know, your source matters a lot, and you will, if you want to malt at home, then you will probably have to do some experimentation for yourself. Okay. And and thanks for the comments. So on this slide, I just have some basic germination regime examples. Just what I said, you will probably have to do some experimentation for yourself, but it's nice to have a starting point for different grains. Okay, so the next step after successful germination would be kilning and toasting. Some also call drying the grains withering. I've heard that term. But the purpose is that we're stopping the processes inside the grain. We're achieving a stable product. That's actually important here, because if you just let it grow, then it would eventually this grain or the seed would start using up the sugars that it produce. So we would actually fall on the contrary of what we want to achieve. Preserving enzymes. So kilning can be done in a way that enzymes are preserved. Here it's important to rely more on high volume airflow rather than higher temperatures. The proteins are degraded to some level. And of course, most importantly, flavor and coloring compounds are created. And yes, for example, kilning technique I would use would be starting at like 30 degrees Celsius and slowly raising that up to 70 degrees Celsius with a high airflow. If somebody is doing it at home and you don't have a like a food dehydrator, which can be perfectly used for this, but if you don't have one, you can also just put put the grains in the oven and just slowly bake them and make sure they are dry at the end. So you can also toast the grains. I have in the beginning done that in the oven, but then also on a stovetop in a pan. That also works well. Of course, you will have less enzymes and less fermentables if you do it at high temperatures, but you might as well get more body. So the final product has to look good, smell good, and taste good. I remember we had a presentation from Ed Golden about malting a long time ago, and I remember him stating this, and of course this is very important. It has an even color. We achieve a very low 1 to 4.5% moisture, so it has to be very dry, and it stores very well. This is especially true for dark malts that they need to rest a few weeks before you use them. Otherwise, they will contribute some burnt flavors to the beer, which is undesirable. But some say it's best to just wait some with every malt. Others say that it's barely noticeable, so I guess this is up for a debate. Yes, and I said they store for a long time. Of course, if you want to make diastatic malts, so the enzymes will be less active after a while, so you want to use those earlier. Some techniques for malting: rotary drum machines are used on large-scale tower malting machines. These Saladin machines, I think I'm missing a letter D here. Anyway, they are basically like floor malting, automated, machinerized. And of course, floor malting is a very ancient technique, but it works very well. So some people convert milk coolers, which is a good idea, and some people also build smaller drum machines, like I have built one. I will show you in the video in a second. This was my rotary, home scale rotary drum machine I produced, and it just didn't work out. And anyway, that was actually very reassuring to me that the key is not really turning the grain, and it's really more just hitting the right temperatures and the right moisture content, and then the seeds will grow. Of course, if you want to make malt on the industrial scale, like 500 kilograms, 1 ton, 2 tons, then of course people get smart, and that's why they invent these all sorts of machines, like a tower or rotary drum or even the Saladin machine. But on the home scale, if you want to malt 3, 4, 5, or 10, 20 kilograms, I don't think this is really necessary. On the left here, you can see one of these machine that I have built and worked very well. in which I was able to control the temperature, and I had these perforated steeping bucket sort of. So I was also able to steep the grains with that container, and also put it in an oven and kiln them and toast them. And now we have arrived to my little project, which I've been working on for quite some time now. I call it the Grain Monster, and it's basically what it is a Raspberry Pi based automated solution for malting. And what it does is it controls the cycles. The key features are the timing is automated. It has in and outlet valves. It controls the water level, and it controls the temperature. It can both heat and cool. It has a user interface, and it's easy to program. It's all stainless, so it's easy to clean, and it fits in my kitchen. I can show you in this image here. This is the user interface, and basically what it does is you can program these cycles, like a steeping cycle first at 10 degrees Celsius for 4 hours, then an air rest phase at 26 degrees Celsius for 8 hours, rinsing, and it's visualized on this diagram, and it basically just takes the grains through these cycles. So it steeps them in water, and then it strains them, and it's all automated, and you have data logged at the same time. So this project is still under development. I hope I can share more and more of this with you guys, and if you want to see what's up with it, then you can visit our website, or even better, not a lot of content up there yet, but I've been working on it. You can also, of course, follow it on Facebook, and that's where I will hopefully very soon share some photos of nice and toasty molds made with the machine. Okay, and we have arrived to the discussion and Q&A, and thank you for your attention and patience.
One quick question I had is, if you said that, you know, like after you malt it and you dry it down to, I think it was 4% moisture. Yeah. If I dried mine too far, will that like hurt the malt, or is that just like at least get it down there?
Yeah, that's a good question. No, so I don't think you can dry them too much. And it the range was from 1% to 4.5, right? 1% is like really, really dry. So
okay,
so it's already like actually quite difficult to achieve that. So yeah, I mean, my only concern would be if you're like aiming for diastatic malts, but even then, I don't think it's actually difficult to achieve that kind of low level of moisture.
Right. I mean, I know I took some of the sorghum that I sourced. It's already malted, and I threw it into, basically it's like a coffee roaster.
Mm-hmm.
And I drew steam off it, or some moisture off of it, for, I don't know, the first hour I was roasting it. But I mean, it was very, very little. It just like, there's a clear dome that goes over the top of it, and you know, I got some condensation on that. That was really about it. But
yeah, right. Okay. Well, it could be condensation, but that's vaporing off. But it also can be like smoke, right? When
yeah,
if you're actually burning it.
Yeah, this was I was roasting or whatever the lowest setting on the machine is. So it was like maybe 110 C.
Or okay. Something. Yeah, that's yeah. That you can get a pretty good toast at 110 C.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I had a question on just when you're getting started out, because I think a lot of people that will watch this, or even a lot of people in the club, probably have never done it before. And mm-hmm. So I know that from Ed's presentation, which was a few years ago, he just basically said he stopped doing it because of the contamination issues.
Mm-hmm.
And so like when you're starting out, when you started out, was that a frequent experience where you're like, oh, it's moldy, I got to toss it, I need to look at doing something different? Like what's the, I guess, what does it look like from, how do you get from beginning to making malts that actually are usable? Like, is that learning yeah. curve really hard or is it really okay. easy?
Yeah, thanks. That's a very good question. So I guess I was lucky, and I was lucky because I started with the, with buckwheat, if I remember correctly. And that worked super well. Now, I also at the same time, I tried millet, and that was just a catastrophe. So it took me a year or more when I was able to source millet. That was also good, and I also had the correct techniques to hold it at the right temperature. So really the thing here is that as I said, the buckwheat will germinate at as low as 10 to 12 degrees Celsius. So lentil would germinate at the temperatures as low as like 6 degrees Celsius. So that's basically the temperature of your fridge, you know, and it's very, I mean, mold can, of course, there are many, many different kinds of molds, and they can grow at those temperatures, but extremely slowly. And I think, so if you start with the grains that are easy to germinate, then you have a very high chance of success. It's a lot more difficult with other grains that like millet and rice that need higher temperatures. Then of course you will have to pay attention to getting the grains from the right source, you know, they're not moldy to begin with. And then also, so the situation with mold is actually a bit tricky, that, what is harmful is not the mold itself, but the toxins produced by the mold. It's kind of, I like to think of it as, you know, like the poop of the mold. at the time when this starts to develop, you can actually see it, you can, you know, smell it. So because some people are afraid of mold for the reason that this fungi, mold is a fungi, right? That it can penetrate the food products while they're not really visible. But it's also has to be said that it's not the fungi itself that's causing the problems, but the toxins that it produces, and it has clear visible sign. So it's you know, you can see that it has a white or green or, you know, maybe some other color patches, and it gets smelly. And of course, if you have any suspicion that that's what's happening, then you just have to toss it out. But I think I might be talking too much about this. What I really should be talking about it is that if you sorry, one moment, JP, is that if you choose the right grains, then you have a very high chance of success, is what I want to say.
I've got a couple questions for you, Peter.
Okay. Yeah, thanks.
I actually came across your Facebook page and then your website a few months ago, I think right after you first launched it. And I was really excited to see it. I had toyed around with the idea of malting my own back in like 07 and 08. But specifically for the reason of being afraid of mold, I decided to go a different direction and decided instead just to focus on brewing with what I could get. And in Oregon, that was a lot of things, and we had more, seemed like, every year. So, but I used to, as I mentioned in the chat, I used to roast my own grain for color that was not malted, and found that the color was always more stable when I would let it hang out in a brown paper bag in my closet for a week after I roasted it before I used it in brewing. So definitely that tracks for me as like giving it a rest. Otherwise, if I'd put it right into a batch of beer, the color would just all fall out and I'd have maybe an amber colored beer or just a pale colored beer, even though I put all that roasted malt in it. My question for you is, I am really interested in the automated malting machine that you're making. What's the capacity of it? And I have a kilogram to pound conversion thing right up here right now. Okay. So feel free to tell me kilograms and I will tell you how many pounds it is.
Thanks. I actually have, one pound is like 0.4 kilograms roughly. So actually that's one I can kind of convert. But so the capacity here would be between, it of course depends on the kind of grain you're using, but it would be roughly 15 to 20 kilograms.
Oh, wow. That's the volume. Yeah. So that's like 33 to 44 pounds of grain. That's a lot bigger than I had thought it would be.
Sounds correct. Well, it's a 28 liter volume machine.
Sure. I mean, I think the other interesting thing about this, and I don't know how many people have really like dug into the history. I've talked on some podcasts about kind of like my exploration of the roots, not of gluten-free brewing, because we've all been there for the roots of gluten-free brewing, but rather the roots of like continental European brewing. And if you go back to, the middle of the 19th century, you have the invention of a lot of these like drum roasters and different malting techniques that came over, and kilning techniques that were kind of being spread around by Sedlmeyer and Dreyer and different things like that, literally stealing them from breweries like Bast in England, and then bringing them back to Germany and Austria. And one of the cool things that I've been learning about is that everybody back then, like there was no commercial maltster that everybody got their grain from. If a brewery was making beer, they were malting their grain. And they were doing it with some kind of process that might yield something that was good, might yield something that was dark and murky and not very good. But everybody was doing that. And so you ended up with a lot less of like, you know, your crystal, you put a little bit of crystal, a little bit of biscuit, and a little bit of this and a little bit of that. And you had more just of these grains that were malted to the point barley, where it was still diastatic, had diastatic power to it, but also might have a little bit of color because of being exposed to smoke, or might have color because it was a pale malt, but they were using a mash cooker in order to do the step mashing, and that's like a Vienna. And And it's really cool. Like the idea of brewing a beer with a malt that I've malted on site at my brewery, so that basically nobody else can do it as long as it's good, is really like romantic to me.
I love that. Yeah, I love that. I love that. Thanks. Yeah.
Yeah. And you got one sale, Peter. One sale.
Oh, thanks. Yeah. Yeah.
I might take one too. if this project with the meadery goes through, that could be really prime for us, because like the point we're at is sourcing grain, you know, that kind of like Peter's talking about, sourcing grain that's gluten-free, you know, celiac safe, millet or buckwheat, and then getting it malted. I mean, there's local maltsters we can, and grain farmers that we can work with, but you know, like can I even get them to do the cleaning that's required, you know, to pass muster? And if we can malt it ourselves, that would be huge. And I think you said, JP, what, about 25 to 30 pounds is the capacity?
Yes, 30. Yes.
30 to 40.
Yeah, 30 to 40 pounds.
Sounds yeah, great. So that's in the... I think that would be... It's enough that it's worth doing. Okay. It's small enough that the risk is like... You know, it's not like we're trying to do, you know, 2,000 pounds or some shit.
Okay, well... To respond to both of you, in so something that came to my mind is that... you know, I mean, of course you know this, but barley has been selected for malting and brewing for centuries, and also the process at the same time has been developed for the same amount of time, and we have a lot to catch up on. And actually, part of why I needed a machine like this for myself was a consistency, so I can make sure that even if it's, you know, difficult to source the good quality grains from the same source, so it's difficult to get consistency on the source side, at least so I can make sure that I can be consistent on the process side. And it's also very important because, you know, we work with buckwheat, rice, millet. Some even may work with corn, amaranth, oats. And these grains are all completely different. While barley is just one grain, right? So we have to use a very different approach to all of these grains, and there I think having consistency and also the idea with this machine is that you know, since it's fully programmable, you could save a germination regime. And you could just start that later. You could also share it, because it's quite easy. Say, you know, you have for your rice, let's say you have a good regime. Let's say you steep it for 24 hours at, I don't know, 6 degrees Celsius water, and then you let it sit for I don't know how many, let's say 2 days at 27 degrees Celsius. I'm simplifying the process now, but then let's say you have found this great way, this good regime, germination regime, to work on your malt, and then you can just very easily, you know, share that with someone else who is trying to malt rice at the same time. And I think that would be great.
Well, the other thing that's really exciting about this for me is that, and I don't want to, I'm not saying that there's anything that anybody's doing wrong in the commercial space. But this is also new malting grains that aren't barley for use in beer that usually has barley in it, that's traditionally brewed with barley, that there's a lot of intellectual property that's not out there yet, that's not mm-hmm. being shared. And I know on the brewing side, some of us, especially in Zero Tolerance, are trying to make that up and trying to share everything we know so that everybody can make great beer and not just keeping that intellectual property about mash techniques and brewing techniques to ourselves. So like that idea of being able to share a particular regime of mashing, or sorry, of malting is really cool. And getting that information out there about like what set points is it important? What temperature points is important for, you know, for example, making a Vienna buckwheat, really cool, or a Vienna rice, like something that's close to a pale, but has a little bit more flavor development to it than just a pale malt. So I really want to say thank you. And also, when's it available?
Well, thanks, JP. So as I said, it's still under development. I have this prototype now that is working. I am planning on adding more features later. So now it is able to go through a successful germination process, but the kilning is done outside of this machine now. I would like to implement that. There are also other plans to implement scale monitoring, so like the weight monitoring, to also be able to monitor water absorption. Right now I see two ways for the development. One would be is more an application where to a very large degree the designs would be open source, and maybe you could order a PCB or maybe some sort of kit where you can, and then you can build upon that and apply that to make some sort of machine for yourself. And use the software that was developed also on that machine. And another way to go would be to have something like a consumer-ready product, but I guess needless to say, that's a very lengthy and tedious process. With full honesty, right now I'm at the position where I'm trying to discover possibilities and try to see and decide if that's possible and if that could be worked out, because obviously what I see is that's where the community would benefit the most, and there has been a lot of interest from barley maltsters and brewers as well, I don't know, Kayla, am I allowed to say this, but this machine would also work for barley.
Sure. Yeah, if they can bankroll it, why not? Yeah. This model is kind of like I think of the digital hydrometers, like the tilt versus the ice spindle. It's sort of a similar situation where you can pay a premium to have it sent to you pre-built and ready to go, or you can assemble all the materials and do it yourself. And then there's probably some people who are happy to assemble it for you and, some price.
Yeah, that's, I have actually built a couple myself and that works great. And it's really, it's just really great how that works. And it's all up there and people can build it for free for themselves.
But a lot of people probably aren't going to be ready to take on or pick up a soldering gun and start doing it. It's probably going to weed out some of the individuals, but maybe, maybe there's some hybrid solution out there where you could there's representatives who could build it, distribute it from parts of the world.
Yeah, and let me say this: if you guys, just yeah, if you want to help me with this project, then really right now where you can help is show your interest online. So sign up to my Facebook page and or sign up to the newsletter, and that's really where what can at this point help me the most if I, you know, but of course I really appreciate everything that you guys commented, and that also helps. But yeah, I can, you know, have some good data points on how many people are interested, and that's what I need at this stage.
Peter, to that point, if you would be able to post up like maybe a summary or the website, your link to your presentation, that information to the group, or provide it to me, or then we can get it up there. So I think it's a small community that we see a lot of the same faces over and over again. So. And I know I would definitely be willing to support you as much as possible. And I know we talked about this kind of beforehand, but sometimes you got to take off the engineering hat and put the sales guy hat on, right? And sometimes that's obviously not really something I like to do a lot. I like to keep the engineering hat on and just by nature, but you got to get a little salesy if you want to get it over the finish line, right? So there's that part too as well.
Yeah thanks, Gail. Yeah, and do we have a bit more time? I would love to ask Grant. I'm so happy to see Grant here because I know he's been doing a lot of home wall thing, and I'd like to ask him about his experience and equipment, if he can share a few words.
I'll answer what I can, mate. Go for it.
Thanks. Yeah. So yeah, what's your what grains do you malt most often, and what equipment would you use for those?
So right now, all I do is what we call French white millet, which is, I think it is, well, it's pretty much Prosso millet. So I have a good supplier of that who cleans and grades it for me. And it's about $30 Australian for a 20 kilo bag. Although to get it is a 3 hour drive to the place for me and 3 hours back, but it's a nice drive, so I don't mind it. I'll buy 10 bags at a time. So steeping wise for that grain, I have a 60 litre pretty much a plastic fermenter, which I've cut the top off, and a 20 kilo pail. So just, I don't know if anyone's bought sorghum syrup in the big pails. It's one of those old sorghum syrup pails. And I've just drilled the whole lot of holes in the bottom. So 2 mil or 1.5 mil holes, and some stainless steel legs, and pretty much steep my grain that way. And then my roaster kiln is a master built smoker with a fan put on it. So I don't know if you've seen the master built smokers. There's a little section on the side where you put your wood chips in, and it sits above the element, the electrical element. I've got a fan that the air goes in through there. I've created some trays with holes in the bottom. So I've used what they call wedge wire, stainless steel wedge wire, which I've got from a scrap dealer. And then, yeah, the air flows up through there and then out the vent, and I can control the time. The air flow is pretty much the same all the way through it and the heat. So that's how I do my millet. I did rice a while back, and I haven't really got back into rice again, but my rice was done in a so smaller versions of the bucket, so a 5 litre version of the bucket with the holes in the bottom, and then a big esky or cooler, and a fish pond or fish tank heater, and set it at around 27 degrees for rice. But rice is one of those things where I don't really get the flavor I want out of it, so yeah, never really got back into it. So, yeah, and buckwheat, we've had a lot of bad droughts here in Australia, so that the buckwheat supplier locally is, he at the time of me contacting him, he had nothing, so I haven't got really into that anymore. And most of the buckwheat we get here in the health food stores is grown in China, which means it's been irradiated as it comes through customs.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, haven't really played with any of the others, lentils or anything like that. But I do get the flavor I want out of millet. So I just find millet is the closest to barley. And yeah, it's easy for me. My mill is set up for millet. It's just my whole system's set up for millet. It's just nice and easy. So I use that. But one of the things I did notice on your drum that you had with I'm not sure what grain was in that.
It was buckwheat.
Was it? Oh, okay. It looked way too wet. So that kind of looked, to me, that looked like a cement mixer with cement in it.
It was a really bad. Yeah, sorry, go on.
Yeah. So, and that sort of leads to Kale's question where he was talking about mold and toxins and that. So in my experience, the wetter the grain is, that's when you start getting all those the molds and stuff like that. So with millet, I know if it's soaked too long and it's way over 45% moisture, you'll get almost like a vomit smell, which is butyric acid or butyric acid or something like that. That I know then the grain's gone way too far, it's too wet. And then I also find that if the grain doesn't get turned enough while it's germinating, and the rootlets start matting together, when I put that in the kiln to dry it, mold will grow in between the rootlets and stuff like that. So then I've got to throw that batch out. So,
So that happens before the kilning?
No, that will happen during. So if I'm making pale malt, so I kiln that first kilning step is at 50 degrees Celsius. That'll happen in that stage there. So that's purely, I haven't turned the grain enough to stop, and that's one of the things with barley malting as well, is they turn the grain a lot to stop that matting happening, because you do need the airflow coming through the grain to dry it properly.
And Grant, are you just hand turning that, or it's almost like floor malting with your hands kind of thing?
So it stays in the bucket. So what I will do is I'll fill the bucket to a point with the raw millet. And then that soaks in the bigger 60 liter fermenter with the top cut off.
Right.
And then your steep time is a big one too. So all your barley stuff says, you know, like an 8 hour soak, 8 hour rest, 8 hour soak. And I also have Andrew Lavery's original document that he put out with malting as well. And I used to use those times, but I find that they're too long. So literally it's a 6 hour steep and that's it for millet for me, because it is such a thin husk on proso millet, and that gives it enough. Saying that, I have to wash the grain through every 12 hours. So we'll have a 6 hour steep or maybe even a 7. I wouldn't go along longer than 8. The bucket gets lifted out of the water and it, because of the holes in the bottom, just drains off. And then what I'll do is I'll just give that bucket a shake every 12 hours and a wash through. And then the grain bed actually compacts again, give it a shake, make sure all that water's come out of the bottom, because that water at the bottom will soak into the grain. And then you'll have like a layer at the bottom that stinks like the vomit smell.
That's enough to keep the rootlets from matting?
Correct. Yep. And it'll so you will have some growth there, which is a lot longer, like it'll grow quicker than others, because in the bucket it does get quite hot. It'll get up to 50 degrees, and I know a lot of people say, oh, that's too hot, it's going to degrade the enzymes, but I'm finding it's not. I'm finding it actually gives a good flavor to the millet. So my beer that I make with my pale malt tastes completely different to what Two Bays makes with Grouse's pale malt, and it's a more, I would
probably say it's probably more like a Maris Otter to a normal Turo flavor. It's just got that, I don't know, sweeter maltiness to it. And I think that's got a lot to do with the heat. But yeah, it will grow. So that bucket will have maybe, I don't know, a third of the grain in it raw. By the time it's ready to put in the kiln, that bucket, that 27 liter bucket, is nearly full because of the growth in the grain and the acrospires and the rootlet. Go on.
One thing that happened to me was rice, though it was a millet, is that I've never experienced any molding in the kiln phase or at the late germination phase. I mean, I usually got those in while trying to germinate, right? Those issues. Okay. But once what something happened to me when I was it wasn't millet, it was rice, so it was quite different. But I noticed something similar to what you were you just described, is that I noticed that some really thin growth at the rootlets, and they kind of grow together.
Yep.
And I was afraid that was more than that was fungi. What do you call those? The mycelium developing there.
Oh yeah. Yep.
Yeah, but I actually looked at it under the microscope, and I realized it was actually the part of the root itself.
Okay.
Because as you imagine, when the plants they grow the rootless, they spread, and yes. they actually look like roots. They were just super super tiny thin.
Yep.
And it also didn't smell bad. So what was interesting is that it. Unlike how you described your experience, but in this case it was it looked a bit weird, but it didn't smell bad at all. So that's why I thought this needs closer attention, and it was just the rootlets themselves.
yeah well you always got to be cautious too, because really realistically we don't know what's in, like there's been no testing of what's in the grains as we go through the molding process. So, and I know with barley, they used to kiln barley over a smoke source, which produces carcinogenic compounds. So, that we've always got to be careful. But yeah, I think your nose and your eyes are your biggest asset with this. So if it doesn't smell bad, and you, like you said, you put it under the microscope and it was a rootlet, yeah, everything's fine. But yeah, I do, for me, it's easy. If I do a 5 kilo batch and I throw it out, just feeding the birds really, so the birds love it, but it's better than ending up in hospital with a drip in ICU with a food poisoning or blood poisoning or something like that. So yeah, it does pay to be careful. And look, I've worked in a malting plant, we built a malting plant, and I still hear stories about how they throw batches out, and they throw 360 ton batches out because things go bad. So, it's not out of the norm for that stuff to happen. And especially in a commercial environment, I'm sure grouse have issues as well here and there. So, yeah, but I do, with my malting, so that constantly washing the grain through, like that water that comes off is quite, like after the steep, it's a very muddy water. Even though the grains I've got have been cleaned and graded. And then it's probably two or three washes afterwards before the grain starts to, that water that's coming out is clear. So it is washing off a lot of crap, which would be just farm dust, dust from the paddocks and stuff like that. But there's also dried manure and all that sort of stuff out there. But I find the washing constantly, every 12 hours, and when you turn it, tends to really keep the grain clean and not have any issues with mold and that afterwards.
Okay. On our next meeting of Zero Tolerance, home distilling, should you drink the heads and the tails? Will you go blind?
Yes and yes. No, no and yes, sorry.
And I remember, Grant, once, correct me if I'm wrong, but you have sent some millet malt of yours to analysis for diastatic power.
Correct. Yep.
Yeah, and you had confirmed that it was able to self-convert. Is that correct?
It would self-convert. The actual test that they did, and this is one of the issues I find with us being gluten-free brewers, is if we send something to a lab for testing, they use a standardized testing. So they use the standardized barley diastatic testing. So it was literally, I think I call it a Congress test or something like that.
Congress mashing.
Yeah. So it came in at around, I think it was like 24 degrees Littner, which is probably not enough to self-convert. But if, and that's one of, well, I sent it because I wanted it tested and I wanted the color tested and all that sort of stuff as well. Because I don't have any of that test equipment here. But because they've worked with these, that university in the US works with grouse. I would have thought that they might have had a different test for millet, but they didn't. So if you look at what, Andrew, I think it's Andrew Ledley, his PhD study showed that, you know, and my experience doing decanting mashes is that millet is able to self-convert to about 25 to 28 ppg. Not a problem. So, yeah, it's, I don't have the data for any of that, but, yeah, just by me, okay. Me doing that.
Yeah, like sounds great like though. Self, yeah.
Self-converting, yeah.
Yep. Sounds great.
I did write down here, I think it was Stuart asked about where to find the raw grains. So here in Australia, I don't know whether you'd have them in the US, but I say you would, is farm tender websites. So we've got one here in Australia where, so millet's mainly grown in Queensland here. I'm in Victoria, which is other end of the country, and a farmer will grow millet and he'll sell it on that farm tender website. So here in Australia, it's around about between 900 and 1600 a ton. So I just put a question on there and said, is anyone interested in selling it? I'm looking at starting a malting facility, and the where I buy my grain from now, he knew, although there's the people that run the farm tender website actually in that same town. So he introduced me to that guy. He actually came down, he delivered it by hand first up. And yeah, I've had a pretty good relationship with him ever since. So I can just buy as many bags as I want. But yeah, check out the farm tender websites and just, you know, make that contact with the farmers. You might be lucky.
Yeah, it's a good idea. Yeah.
Correct. And bird breeders. So this guy, the millet that he does is all for top end bird breeders. That's why it's all cleaned and graded, because they're quite fussy with what they feed their birds. So yeah, if you can get on to if you struggle with the farm tenders, maybe try bird breeding associations and see where they get their clean millet from. So
that's good ideas. Okay.
Yep.
Cool.
The caution in the US that I've always heard is don't go to your local farm store and buy millet that's intended for bird feed, because it will be treated to inhibit mold growth and it's not suitable for human consumption.
Yes, true. So I've bought millet from, and I've had this on my alt malt page, where I bought it from a farm store and it's been irradiated and it's full of crap and it is bird feed. But what I'm getting is actually from the source. So there's a grower sell to him. He's got massive giant vats, silos on his farm, and he does everything. So he has, it's not just millet, he's got a whole bunch of other grains. And yes, there will be cross-contamination, although I have never found barley or wheat in any of his product. I have found chickpea, but that's added like a very small chickpea. But yeah, you're right, JP. Yeah, you've got to be careful what you get. So your standard farm store, which is like a small feed store, it sells a little bit of hay and that. Yeah, wouldn't go with them. But your bigger, you know, multiple silos, sells multiple grains. yeah, that's where I'd be checking. Yeah, definitely.
I wonder, just to throw this out too, for us in the States, I wonder if, you know, places that do malting of millet, you know, Skagit Valley malting for Stewart and I, for instance, or Grouse in Colorado, like if they would even sell people unmalted grains, right? To malt yourself, you could probably do that as well.
It might be worth asking, because so we've got a malting facility here in Australia that does it does everything. So it does, like, and he's a farmer as well, so he does, it's called Voyager, and he does buckwheat, sorghum, but it's all, you've got to ask for it, and there's minimum amounts, and when I couldn't source millet, he could, and he was happy to sell me clean graded millet, although it was a lot dearer than $30 a bag, plus shipping and stuff. He's in New South Wales, so another half a country to travel, so it wasn't viable for me to get it off him. But the other option too is, and I've been discussing this with a guy who wants to sell gluten-free products from his homebrew store here, is because there's another brewery apart from Two Bays that makes a gluten-free beer in Queensland, and they get their millet now from Voyager, is you could piggyback off those breweries to say if there's a minimum amount that say Jason Yerger gets or something from Grouse, you could ask, can you throw in an extra 100 kilos for me or whatever? So, and that's what I've been discussing with this bloke as well, because he's from Queensland, and Voyager malting is near, it's in New South Wales, but it's near the Queensland border. And I've said to him, well, that's probably something you could do. You could ring Voyager and say next time, Four Hearts Brewing, or Wild Polly, which is another gluten-free beer here. He does sorghum and millet in his beers. Next time they run a batch through, see if you can put an extra couple of 100 kilos or 100 kilos in for you. Because honestly, if you got 100 kilos of malt, you'll use it. You're not gonna not use it. It's just having a place to store it. So
I know here in the States, Grouse and Eckert will sell unmalted grain on the commercial side. I don't know if a home brewer were to ask if the offer is also open. But also one thing that could be open for certain questioning is Grouse and Eckert are buying from independent farmers, and, you know, saying, hey, could you give me a name of somebody to buy grain from? And they might be willing to do it, because they're farmers that are trying to make a living selling the stuff. And there's only so much that Grouse and Eckert can buy from them anyway. So more sales for that farmer help support their family. So
nice. Or we could just buy it from you, JP.
Or buy it from me. Come on. I had a question about Peter had noted something about cyanide and sorghum. Do you have more insight into that? Because I know, Grant, you've worked with sorghum probably more than most people.
No, I haven't. I've never used sorghum at all, and it's purely because of the well, there's cyanide, there's another mold that grows on the skin as well. I've never, and it is quite easy to get here in Australia, sorghum, because it's just a cattle feed here. But yeah, it's not been something that so the best way to put it is, when I first had O'Brien's beer, there was this burnt rubber flavor to the beer.
Right.
And it's not in there now, and it's purely, and this is my theory, and I've seen it because I know I can't remember his name, the guy who runs Brent Ground Baker, mentioned it as well. That's it. So one of his beers was in a beer competition, or someone did a tasting of it and mentioned the burnt rubber as well. I think it's a flavor that's only certain people pick up. And that sort of put me off, because O'Brien's used millet and sorghum, and that put me off sorghum a lot. And talking to Andrew Lavery, sorghum is one of those, he said his experience with sorghum is that every year it changes, and you might get a year where the sorghum malts really well and there's no off flavors and everything's fine. And he said, and then the next year it's just stuffed and you've got to use more millet and a few other things to just keep the consistency in their product. So, so saying that now, I don't want to put anyone off O'Brien's beers because their beers are really good and they win a lot of gold medals. But when I first tried it, when I was diagnosed 16 years ago now, that's what I picked up in my first flavor. It was a very chemically burnt rubber flavor. And I think that's my palate, not the beer. I just didn't want, so it would just put me off sorghum completely. So I've never gone there. Yeah.
But it seems that that cyanide is coming from a mold that grows on sorghum or that can grow in sorghum when it's being malted.
It could be. The other thing I would suggest too is that a lot of plant life when it starts producing does produce a product that is and sprouting does produce cyanide. So so I know apricot kernels have it in it. So as far as I know, when apple seeds are germinating, they've got it in it. My malt, when I eat the green malt that's got the shoots coming out just to get the flavor, sometimes there's a bitterness there. It would not surprise me if that is some type of cyanide or some type of compound like that.
So I think
it's a naturally occurring thing. Well, it is a naturally occurring thing, but I don't think it's at a level where it's gonna kill you. I think it's just one of those things where you see and you go, "Well, cyanide, well, that kills people." but you know, like it's one of those things. Well, you know, copper in your, it's like copper in small amounts or zinc or something like that it's a metal, but it's good for your system and it's good for brewing.
Sorry guys, can you hear me?
Yep.
Yes.
Oh, okay. Sorry. Yeah, I just accidentally turned my mic off. Yeah, I was just sorry to interrupt you, Grant.
Right.
I was just going to touch on this thing with the cyanide. So the cyanide for sorghum, it is produced by the sorghum itself.
Okay.
And it's not only in the grain, but also if, as Grant mentioned, it's very often grown for cattle feed. And it has also cyanide in the stem of the plant. Mm-hmm. And during the life stage of this sorghum, it sometimes it has more cyanide, sometimes it has less. But actually, the cattle, those who use it for cattle feed need to be also cautious with that. But also, as Grant said, you know, a lot of food products or plants like almonds. You know, some cherry pits are also used in the food industry for cherry flavoring, and they also have cyanide, and it's said to be a volatile compound. So it you know, by it can be boiled off, or it's not something to be super worried about. It's also, you can also taste, actually, if you taste like raw sorghum seeds, you can actually taste that it has this is that similar to, it could be similar to what people describe as a twang when they talk about the sorghum tasting beer. But it has this it's kind of like a bit like a sour taste, but it's an edgy, definitely an edgy taste. Sorry, I don't know how to, better to describe it, but you can actually taste the cyanide in it.
Okay.
It's still, my point is that it never hurts to be cautious, right?
Right.
Very true. Yeah.
Well,
hey, Kim, you had a question.
I sell sorghum malt, so.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
I actually had a comment on Brian's question. When we were talking about making this beer, I had talked to James at Groundbreaker, and he said it was based, that what they had found is if they just boil the sorghum, not malted, just boil the sorghum and on a specific schedule that it doesn't have that either twang and to avoid the cyanide. So I talked to him about that.
Well, and what I would say about sorghum, because
sorghum malt beers.
We use.
I said I have not picked up the twang in any of my sorghum malt beers.
I think that flavor is for some people more of a like the baby vomit or some of the other flavors, something that some people taste more than other people do. I also have a little bit of a theory because we use sorghum in some of our beers at Beerly. And my theory with sorghum is that some of that metallic taste that people can sometimes get comes from like scorching on the bottom of the kettle. Yeah. We don't have any direct heat in our boil kettle because we use all low density electric elements. And so we don't get that scorching. And I don't pick up that metallic flavor in our beers that are made with sorghum. So that's my two cents.
Okay, so we're at marathon session here. So
we're what?
See what happens when we're apart for so long.
I wanted to close it down in the next couple of minutes, but does anyone else have any other questions or comments for Peter, Grant, anyone else?
Thank you, Peter. Thank you, Grant.
No, thank you.
Thank you, Peter.
Thank you, guys. It was a great
time. Following and hopefully getting a system or advice or something from you.
Oh, thanks.
Peter, have you done a lot of reaching out to people who are malting gluten-free grains to kind of see what the design of their system looks like in order to how they've designed them in order to kind of overcome the specific challenges with gluten-free stuff? Because I know I've been, I don't know what I can say because I might've signed an NDA, but I've been in both Grouse's facility and seen what they're using, which is basically kind of a drum malting setup. And I've been in Eckert's malting facility, which is much closer to what you're doing with kind of like a table that has water that's circulating, and you know he's going to the length of the acrospire and then starting.
Yeah, I don't think you have disclosed any secrets. I mean, sorry, what is his name? Eckert.
Jim
Eckert. Yes, thank you. He's been he was a guest at one of our club meetings, right? And he did talk about his techniques and also his equipment, you know, of course, I have done a lot of research online, whatnot. I think that's in part why I'm so excited to be able to see and talk to Grant now, because, you know, we have engaged in a lot of, online discussion so far. Of course, a big part of that was the zero tolerance, Facebook threads. But I think this is a really small community, right? People who do gluten-free home malting, honestly, I've been maybe a bit foolishly just going after my own thoughts and experiments and instincts and whatnot, you are right, it's probably time to talk more to people about it and also listen to people with the experience and meaningful thoughts. But I think correct me, JP, if I'm wrong, but I think it's a super super small community, and I don't, maybe it's different in Portland, but I'm just joking here.
No,
but,
I think you're absolutely right. You know, I think that in the United States, at least, the availability of malt that's commercially malted has really kind of made it a very, very select few that actually want to go after it. I don't know really any. I mean, most of us that talk about it talk about how we used to look into it, and then Grouse came along or Eckert came along, and it's just so much easier to buy from them.
What if they didn't? And that's the case in Europe right now, right?
Yeah, everybody who talks about it is always, you know, in Canada or in Australia or in Europe, where they're malting their own. Absolutely.
Yeah. And I also, when you earlier talked about how masters in the old days, they just made malt for themselves they just made malt for themselves. And that I have some literature on malting at home, and this was very interesting to, you know, read for me how, but this was pre, you know, the development of natural sciences today as we know it, but still they had really good techniques, you know, they had the sound troubleshooting, and I think there should be a lot of people to be courageous when it comes to malting, you know, that if people were able to make malts, you know, 300 years ago and brew with it, and they were able to do it, you know, 1,000 years ago, then I don't, you know, with the abundance of technology and the information that we have today, we don't have excuses. We shouldn't have excuses.
Yeah, you know, like, I don't want to make us go a super longer meeting, but I think everybody should hear, like, really 200 years is as old as, like, the kind of beer styles that we think of now are no more than 200 years old. Before that, you know, you had the, like, dark turbid beers, even in Europe, that people were producing. You know, Pilsner is a very recent phenomenon. And pale malts are a very recent phenomenon. Being able to separate your heat source from your actual grain that you're drying, it doesn't go back more than, like, what is it, like 400 years, Grant, or something like that, 15, 14 or something? So it's all really, so we always talk about, the barley brewers always talk about a 10,000 year history of beer making, but the beer was really bad for most of that time. It was really, like, just something to get your nutrients, because you were probably basically starving and you weren't getting what you needed to live. And so it was helping supplement your diet with this beer, and it was making water safe to drink.
Is that a way to sell gluten-free beer?
Yeah. Well, gluten-free beer has been made in Africa for 13,000 years. It's just... It's the African tradition. It's very different. It's a very different beverage, but it has actually a longer history making with the ingredient set that we all talk about all the time, that we all use, has a longer history and tradition than barley does. But the thing, the innovation that we're living through right now in the last 17 years is applying continental Europe, European brewing styles and standards to beer brewed without barley. That's the innovation. That's what we're talking about these days. That is new.
Great point. Great point.
Go ahead, Peter.
Sorry. Go ahead. No, there's no, sorry, Kel. There's no, nothing important.
I was going to say, it sounds like, well, I hope Peter, Grant, you guys that are doing this stuff, or anyone that does move in the direction of home malting, gluten-free grains, hope you guys are writing all this stuff down, right? Because it sounds to me like a perfect segue into the next meeting, which is, it sounds like a perfect opportunity to have a book about, you know, malting gluten-free grains. And it sounds like that there's, you know, differences between all these different grains that that you guys have pointed out through your own experiences, right? It's kind of like would be a helpful roadmap, right, for others out there that if they were to choose to go down that path, it would be really beneficial to kind of stand on the shoulders of you guys that have already gone through that, right? So they don't have to make those same mistakes that you may have already made previously, right? So I think it's great that you guys are doing this. It's really cool. And really interesting. And the segue is that in May, what we're going to do is we're going to have Bob Kiefer as our guest. Hopefully, I have to confirm that with him. He's probably shocked to know this, but because his book that is titled Gluten-Free Brewing from Brewers Publications is set to come out. It was originally supposed to come out on my birthday, July 25th, but apparently I checked it today and the website now says it's going to be released September 26th. Yeah. So I'm guessing that's, of course, COVID, supply chain, yada, yada, yada. But he has a book coming out, and I know that Stuart and I were providing some feedback on some of that stuff. And I don't know, JP, if he hit you up with anything about that book, but...
I cannot wait for you guys to see the recipes that are in that book. I'm so excited about them.
Yeah, that's so excited cool.
about the recipes so, from yeah. Beerly. And I can't say anything about them. I've signed that I won't release them to anybody until they're published.
So hopefully we'll be able to squeeze some information out of Bob, and he can at least get on a little bit of a book tour to get some visibility on that. So that's coming.
Pre-purchase your copy too, right, Kale?
What's that?
Pre-purchase your copy on Amazon.
Yeah, I think if you pre-order a book, it helps it like get up higher on like bestsellers list or something like that if you pre-order the book. So I know, actually, I think I'm going to go do that right now because I've got some Amazon gift card money that I'm going to go pre-purchase the book, pre-order the book.
There you go. So if you get that extra $100 of Amazon gift card money coming your way in the next few months, just... think about Bob, right? He's got to put food on the table. Anyways, no, this is what great. This Bob? Is a great meeting. Peter and I were talking beforehand. I was like, oh, we want to keep it under an hour. People get tired. It's yada, yada, yada. And we're just going and going and going for now. It's over 2 hours. So I think I'm going to call it. Thank you so much for joining everyone across the world. And so again, the next meeting is going to be in 2 months. We're doing this every 2 months now, so the end of May. I try to keep these at times that work for as many people as possible, so maybe this time frame works a little bit better. It's not really beer 30 for me, right? But I think that maybe we'll just continue to have them around this time. So anyways, happy brewing. Thank you so much for joining.
And yeah, thanks for everyone.
Thank you.
Thanks for the time.
Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.
Cheers. Bye.
Thank you, Peter. Bye.